I, Mayank Joshi, student manager of Sri Balaji Society, is here in front of you to introduce you to the senior director of HR and international HR head at Synopsys, Mr. Anshuman Ray, sir. Sir has close to 25 years of professional experience in human resource management. Before joining Synopsys, sir worked for General Electric and RPG Enterprises. Sir has held various leadership roles in HR business development and has led cross-functional teams across countries and has been felicitated for his contribution in the areas of execution excellence, leadership development, performance improvement, and delivering best practices in HR function. Sir is an avid speaker, coach, and teacher. He has delivered several presentations in management schools, professional forums, in and beyond the country. Now, I would like to invite our speaker of the evening, Mr. Anshuman Ray, sir, to enlighten the student managers with his words of wisdom.
So let me qualify Synopsys by a few things that you may not be aware of. The first, we are one of the 15th largest software companies that world has. 15th largest software company that world has. Our revenues are to the tune of $2.65 billion, and we are pretty close to hitting a $3 billion mark. We are also a S&P 500 company. You people know what an S&P is? Absolutely. Wow. So we are a S&P 500 company. Now, what do we basically do? There are three business verticals. The first vertical is electronic design automation. Okay. How many of you have been using a handset? I'll be surprised if I do not see any hands raised. So how many of you use a handset? A smartphone? Yeah, awesome. Any handset today is driven, or the functionality of this chip is handset is driven by a chip inside, right? The designers of the chip have used our products to integrate these millions and millions of circuits into the small geometry. The size of the chip in the handset could be as large as a nail, a thumb nail. Okay? So, first part of the business is that we offer software products that helps the designers to integrate these millions of circuits into the small geometry. We are already at a stage of what nodes? Do you know that what is the typical node that we are talking about these days? 64 was what we have heard about. It was down to 28. In the last few months, we are hearing about a 5 nanometer node. The complexity of fabricating a chip at a 5 nanometer is immensely complex. And these are nanotechnologies, so you don't get to see the circuits which the chip has through your naked eyes, right? So this is the first vertical. The second vertical is called the IP business. Now this is best understood if you have played in the past as a child with Lego blocks. How many of you can associate with Lego blocks? Yes. So there are certain standard components that go into a chip. If every designer had to do that time and again, there would be a loss of productive time. So standard blocks are put in with a little bit of a customization, and those are called the IP business. That's the second vertical. These two are purely in the VLSI segment. Now tune in for the third one. The third is absolutely orthogonal. We have just started it 3 years back, and we are into software security. What does this vertical do for us? Anywhere, any code that is being written for banks or for any Chevron petrol bunk, Shell petrol bunk, banks, wherever there is these large databases and codes are being written, our products are ensuring that nobody can hack your system. So we provide software integrity by addressing security as well as quality of the code right at the application development stage. Okay? So those are the three verticals of Synopsys. And I'm sharing this with you because maybe if Dame Luck greets you, you may be in a position to shake hands with Synopsys at a point in time. So there are these three verticals. One is EDA, the second is IP, and the third is software security business. We are primarily headquartered out of Mountain View, USA, California-based company. In India, our footprints are in Bangalore, Hyderabad, Mumbai, Noida, and Delhi. India happens to be the second largest region beyond US in terms of the investment by virtue of the number of employees we have, so it's a strategic hub for the company. We are now wanting to transition to the next section, which is a small quiz, right? Are you guys ready? Okay. Now, the answers to the questions that comes up on the screen need not be disputed because the research has pretty much proven that these are the right answers, and the author of this quiz is a management guru, people who have been pursuing HR. How many of you are from HR? You must have heard about a gentleman by the name Dave Ulrich. So this is from his book and his research. Okay? The first question that comes up is this. I'll read it out. What is the dominant source of the necessary lessons to be an effective and successful executive? All of you are aspiring for jobs, right? I don't think there is anybody who says that I would not want to sign up for a job. And you want to be successful executives. So the question is, what is the dominant source of necessary lessons to be an effective and successful executive? There are four options. Five options. First, formal schooling in an institution like this. B is jobs. C is mentors and bosses. D is peers and role models. And fifth is all of the above are about equal in influence. I hear C, I hear D. Okay, one sec. How many of you are A? Raise your hands. That was a good one, F. B. C. Okay. D. E. Okay. Stay with me. The correct answer, which has been researched so very thoroughly by the world-reputed scientist in HR, is it's B, jobs. Jobs. Solid amount of research backup shows that it's jobs that are pivotal to the success of a professional. Jobs. Are we ready for the second question?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The best mix, hear me out, the best mix of developmental remedies to help someone build critical skills is, it starts from 70% jobs and tasks, 20% boss, coach, and mentors, and 10% self-development courses. And it goes all the way down to 10% jobs and tasks, 20% bosses, coaches, or mentors, and 70% self-development courses. If you can blow this section up, please. How many of you are saying A? How many of you are saying B? 50% jobs and tasks, 25% bosses, coaches, mentors, 25% self-development. B. C. I still see a few hands for C, which is 33, 33, 33. Have you people chosen an opportunity or a career in politics? equally distributed, 33, 33, 33. So D is 25% jobs, 25% bosses, but 50% self-development. D, okay, and the E is 10% jobs, 20% bosses and coaches, and 70% self-development. E, okay, so I didn't see a clear pattern. Few hands for each of the answers. And the correct answer is A. Substantial amount of research backs up the fact that your self-development, which is pivotal to your success in the corporates or in your professional pursuit, is an outcome of jobs and tasks. Third question, are we ready? Okay. What kind of jobs matter most for long-term development? What kinds of jobs matter most for long-term developments? Jobs requiring stark transition and first-time experiences, like Mohan, the spy of Infosys, before he, you know, pulled the plug. He was a chief of finance and he moved into chief of HR role. That's a stark transition. B is functional switches, moving from one function to the other. C is multiple rotation assignments in an early career. D is product line or a business unit switches. And E is being promoted to your boss's job. How many of you are A? Just one, I see. B, C, D, at least nobody D, E. Okay, once again, you missed the cue. Go ahead. The right response is A. There's a solid amount of research backup. Solid amount of research backup that shows that it's jobs that will eventually contribute to the long-term development. So, what's the takeaway of this quiz? On three questions, you understood what? What is key? Jobs. Not that I am undermining the other two, which is coaches, mentors, and self-development, but that is 20 and 10%. Bulk of the competencies, bulk of the skills, bulk of the behaviors, bulk of the traction that your career generates for any company is by virtue of the job that you sign up with. And this is one reason why many companies who offer great jobs weave in job as a part of total rewards. How many are from HR? Have you heard about total rewards? It includes jobs. A quality of job is key because it offers you a lot of opportunity to hone your skills and competencies. That then becomes a career propellant for you. Let's move to the third segment. And the third segment is, what did I go through 24 years back when I passed from a school called XISS, majoring in personal management and industrial relations? And what is it that it greeted me? Stay tuned, because many of you will not be able to believe me when I say and call out the projects that were entrusted in to me, you know, by the company. We all joined RPG Enterprises as a part of the senior management trainee scheme. 25 of us from various institutes, including IIM Ahmedabad, Bangalore, Calcutta. We had certain CAs, then SPJNs. 25 of us joined RPG Enterprises on the 2nd of June 1993. I'll be honest with you, it was so very fun, you know. It was so very nice that we all get selected and, you know, come and join a large corporate house called RPG, which was a multinational. Till about the 7th day, when we get to understand what the program is all about. The first thing that the program stated is no automatic confirmation. You have all joined this program. It's good. Senior management training program will induct you at an assistant manager level, which is, of course, 5 grades beyond the entry level of engineers. So you will be inducted at the assistant manager level. However, there is no guarantee. In the scheme of things for a year, if we were to find out that you do not have the right acumen, we will disassociate. We will, you know, shake hands and say goodbye. The first blow. The second blow, all of us mandatorily had to sign up for a cross-functional project which had no nexus and correlation with the area of specialization. So what was my area of specialization? HR. And I was assigned, I didn't have a choice, I was assigned business development and marketing. Now, tune in to understand what was the complexity and impact of this project. USSR as a country had just broken down by virtue of Mr. Gorbachev's, you know, grand plans. Our export of PILC cables. PILC cables are paper impregnated lead covered cables, which is power cable, 132 kV, extra high voltage cables that we used to export to USSR. That got a stab at the back. We were not able to export, and hence a huge machinery which was imported at the cost of 26 crores of rupees was lying idle. Capacity utilization was at a 6%. And I was tasked by the corporation to convert this so-called cost center into a profit center. So you had two options. Either generate more orders from other countries. Where did we use it? These were used in countries which had extreme climatic conditions, like Russia, Siberia. It used to have a minus 40 degrees, so the cable was covered with lead and paper impregnated. Now, that was clearly not something that we could even attempt to, because our cable company, you know, made a lot of efforts and they didn't see it coming. So we were tasked, or I was specifically tasked, to come up with alternate products out of the machines that can sell and step up the capacity utilization of this machinery from a 6% to, at a minimum, 50%. Now, that required an understanding of the machine, that required an understanding of lead as a product, the alloy that we use, and I would be measured by outcomes in terms of get us the product that this machine can manufacture, which is beyond cables. That was the first assignment that I got. The second assignment that I got was communicate to integrate. The title was very nice, you know. Yes, we in HR, we are supposed to, you know, drive communication, corporate communication. Those days, there was no email, there was no internet, there was only electronic typewriters. So, and printing press was there. So I was chartered with the task to come up with a newsletter for a company to align the workforce, the three cable companies, one in Raebareli, the other in Mysore, and the third one in Thane, Asian Cables Thane. We were amalgamating these, and I was supposed to bring up or come out with a newsletter, which was easy. Till the time I was told that the message from the president to all the employees has to be crafted by me. Now, I am 1 year, 1.5 year in the job. I am supposed to write a message on behalf of the president of the company to all the employees without any assistance. Are you able to get some bit of a feel in terms of what are the sort of jobs that you will get after passing out? Now it is much more than what it used to be. So here is a person who has graduated from a B school in a year's time being asked to write a message from the president as a part of the newsletter for all the employees, which will include vice president up to the workers. The third one is to drive integration. We will have to come up with a common policy manual to streamline operations, to have a consistency around policies, practices. The challenge around this was to get the three different companies, because three different companies were having three different products, three different management styles, how to align, convince, and get them to agree on something which we found very meaningful. And the fourth one was I was asked to get onto a flight, leave for Kolkata, the erstwhile Calcutta, disband a trade union which existed for 14 years. They had a tie-up with a federation. So I was chartered with this task of going to Kolkata, disbanding the whole union that existed for the last 14 years, and not take a flight till I am done with it. So report back closure of disbanding a trade union which was in the sales office. I am introducing these four out of the many to give you a feel and flavor of what will be the sort of jobs that you will get greeted with when you step out, because today technology is much more advanced. But what you need to do is look at the last tagline. What people expect from management graduates is you will be able to solve situations which are high on complexity and profound in terms of business impact. All of us, when we are out of the schools, we will be asked to focus on assignments, sign up for assignments which are high in terms of complexity. There are things that you may not have even heard of or done in the past. High in terms of business impact. And you will be measured around the three Qs, the three vectors. Quality of results, time to results, and cost of results. You get it? Are we on the same page?
Yes, sir.
So complexity versus impact will be at the topmost right-hand block, high on impact, high on complexity, and then you will be asked to deliver quality results within the desired time at the right cost. And this is what happened. How do you think I fared in the first one, which was a cross-functional assignment given to me to transition a cost center into a profit center? I had no engineering background. I had to come up with alternate products. How do you think I fared? Very good, good, somewhat good, poor. Okay. I am now linking this module to the previous section. We had these quizzes, and the response that I got from all of you is that jobs are pivotal in terms of development, right? And giving our career the right sort of a trajectory and momentum. Those days, being a part of RPG, I literally said that this is so weird. You are expecting an HR person to sign up for a business development, you know, sort of a project and then achieve success. Today I say it's unique. And the reason why I say it is unique is the project gave me an opportunity to manage complexities with a high impact. And these are the set of competencies that were required. By the way, I will show you what I scored in a minute's time. And this was the first sort of a success that I got greeted with. But for every project, there will be challenges. If you have to overcome the challenges, there is no other thing than mastering the competencies that is required to address these challenges in the format of 70, 20, and 10. That's the mantra. So it's the job that makes you taller. It's the job that offered me challenges. How well are you able to deal with the challenges in an alien environment is what makes you taller. So things that contributed to the complexity was not the what part, but also what and the how, which is dealing with ambiguity, teamwork was required, influencing your seniors to come up with a product was required, immense amount of grit and perseverance was required. I had to come up with a product which was very different from the existing line. Creativity was required. Using money to do an experimentation talks about taking risks. You had to take a risk, and then, of course, achieving a project within the deadline is result orientation. Right? Likewise, the other assignments offered me a bunch of competencies. If I had to write a message on behalf of the president for all the employees, I was challenged with business acumen. What do I write? You have VPs write up to workmen. What do I write? How do I write? What should be the focus? What should be the verbiage? So it offered me competencies which are business acumen and alignment, networking, communicating, creativity in terms of what can be, you know, done, how differently can we do the same thing, and then result orientation, because everything had a timeline attached. The personal policy manual got me to handle disagreements. When you launch something which is a common minimum program with three different companies following three different practices, the instant feedback was, no, we don't accept this. It has to be this. So how to handle disagreements, how to engage in a crucial conversations where stakes are high, opinions are diametrically opposite, and emotions are very strong. Those are the things that came into play, and I got a feel and flavor of that. And this union disbanding gave me competencies like problem solving, instilling trust amongst the union people, saying that, well, trust us, we will do good to you, we do not have a malefied intent. Listen to them with an open, you know, mind, tune in with your ears, ability to influence them. And then, of course, as an HR person, I had to be familiar with the Trade Union Act and the legislation. So I could not do anything which was deemed as unfair labor practices. So these were the key competencies that came into play. Now, if I tell you today, bulk of my success is attributed to the competencies that got nurtured in the projects that I have done 24 years back, you will start to connect this module with the previous quiz, that it's jobs. Jobs is what will be the foundation for success. How better you do it, how smarter you do it, how efficiently you do it, those are the key things. For people in the room who will not believe me on the cross-functional project, here is what you get to see. I'll read it out. The second para. Okay, this is from my manager then, who was the general manager of business development, Rana Ganguly. And he used to report into the president called A.S. Jatkar, and he says, I would like to place on record my appreciation of the efforts made by Mr. Anshuman Ray in the development and marketing of lead components required by the Department of Telecommunication, as well as constant support and follow-up during the development trials of the product, which have concluded successfully. He then goes and then amplifies my DNA. During the 3 months stay in my department as a part of the cross-functional assignments, I have found that he has a flair for marketing. He calls out a skill that I never thought I had. I have found that he has a flair for marketing and is extremely committed and dependable, the two traits that he chooses to qualify me. And these are the ingredients for success in the professional space. Then he says, although he is not an engineer, this has never come in the way of his being associated with technology development, technical development. He, it seems, is prepared always to learn more and get more information on the subject of his interest. So what happened was, with a lot of effort, and for this, I had to go and walk in the streets of Paithoni in Mumbai, dealing with lead, people who were selling lead components. I had to engage with the chief of metallurgy department of IIT Powai, right? So these things, you know, only comes in when you have a passion, when you have a resilience and perseverance. So in all, this project was something that I succeeded on. We came up with an alternate product which had a huge requirement in the market, and we were able to convert the cost center into a profit center. The other two projects, or the other project that I would want to maybe just share with you, was the message from the president. You will not believe, on the right-hand side, that colored newsletter is the final script which I have written, and on the left-hand side is my handwritten note to the president saying that, hey, Mr. Jatkar, this is what my draft is. And if you were to read this, you would see that he has made corrections only in terms of grammars or English verbiage, not in terms of the content. So in 1.5 years of experience, and he was a person with very, you know, he was very tight-lipped. He did not quite normally acknowledge and appreciate. But to get something from him where he says, Anshuman Ray, very good, that was a big thing for me. And that was a big thing for the company. People couldn't believe that a person with 1.5 years of experience could write a message for the president. So I close this section by saying that choose jobs which offer you an opportunity to nurture competencies, because if you were to draw a thread with the previous section, it is the jobs that will make you taller in your careers, right? It's these jobs that I have signed up early in my career that has made me the little that I have been able to achieve in my professional, canvas today. Any questions on my career insights vis-a-vis the quiz? I now will move on to the last section, which is the trends in B-School. Whatever I shared with you that I was doing in the corporate is something that I see getting extrapolated to the universities and the institutes in today's environment. I'll share with you some insights. I am a member of the corporate advisory board of Chandigarh University. We are closely engaging with them. And what do I get to see Chandigarh University doing? Involving us for selecting students not just is limited to the marks that you score in your plus two and the interviews you have with the university, administrators, but also partnering with corporate. I get to see that. We get to see labs in the institute where IBM is working jointly with Chandigarh University staff to co-create a curriculum that they find it meaningful for their impact to the business vertical. We are also seeing a focus that the institute is offering on transitioning from student to a talent. What is the difference between a student and a talent? Student is a student who passes with the right pedigree, qualifies, and then gets a good score. But talent are people whose employment quotient is well liked by the end customers, which are companies that you would want to sign up with. A talent has a set of competencies which are not just limited to skills and curriculum. So what do I get to see when I'm talking about B-schools today? They are extrapolating the environment of the corporates into the institutions. So it's like a retail. How many of you are from retail? Retail management? None. So retail has got various formats, right? You have a chain of shops called a Shopper Stop. You all would be knowing and be able to relate to Shopper Stop, right? Yes. You have another chain, which is called a hypermarket, where only the space is let out, and various products from various companies are also showcased and shared. We are getting to see an interesting trend in the universities. Good, thank you. Where we see different formats coming up. So there will be a format and a track wherein, you will have students coming in and students passing out. Good marks, bad marks, the person fails. The other sort of formats that we are getting to see is an output getting translated to outcome. The difference between output and outcome is, output is what is produced, outcome is what is produced and valued by your end customers. So student versus talent, right? We are also seeing collaboration and partnership with the institutions to the extent that the professors are no longer just teachers. They are career coaches, they are your mentors, they are your guides. They are also your opportunity brokers. The career development cell in the institutions are translating to not just curriculum and academic excellence, but creating a talent in you, which is not just technical, but technical plus other competencies that make you taller. And it's specific to companies who you are wanting to sign up with. So from autonomous, interdependence, and independence, we are getting to see well connected to the ecosystem through active partnership and collaboration. We are seeing formats where The students are being inducted into the institutions with a close collaboration with the targeted companies. And they pay for the student throughout and through. And then it is that company that you eventually would join. And they nurture you. They are, you know, tailor-making the course to the extent that you have the right DNA, the right behaviors, the right values, and the right competencies that those companies look out for in the students when they are hiring. This model helps the corporations to reduce the lead time and get baked cakes rather than getting students and then they taking up the onus of, you know, baptizing you in the way that you would start making impact. Is there any question? So we are able to see selection processes which are very different. We are able to see an agile curriculum which is not prescribed. Like very many people whom I met this afternoon said that all of a sudden because of the GST, Balaji institutions or the group of institutions have incorporated GST and you have had some lectures around it. So be agile and alert to the ecosystem and then customize the entire curriculum to the extent that your employability doesn't get impacted or gets benefited out of that. We are talking about career development cells, which is not just academic brilliance, but they instill and ingrain key competencies, key behaviors, like innovation, like entrepreneurial orientation, and the likes. The other thing that we are getting to see is institutes having specialization. It's not a plain vanilla. So every institution, like the one where I am a corporate advisory committee member, they have a specialization in terms of offering a security course, which I think is unique in the country. And cybersecurity and application development security is in a boom phase in this region. They are instilling global DNA rather than the regional DNA and the local DNA. We are also seeing institutions which have transitioned from just academia to profit centers. So the faculty and the students come up with innovation, with a lot of creative work, which is then getting productized in the form of customers wanting to buy things from you and you translating this whole institution to a profit center rather than just a cost center or an academic center. And we're also seeing institutions who are offering a lot of flexibility to the students to volunteer and sign up because they say, choose a job you like and you will have to never work for a day. At the end, we are also now seeing universities using machine learning. I know in the last 2.5 days, you have been showered with this artificial intelligence and machine learning. Machine learning is now being used by the institutions to predict the sort of companies that you will be, you know, employable for. Your employability quotient will be higher than what it is. They are using machine learning also to predict environments where you will be successful, and they are priming the, you know, people from corporate, and then the close engagement between the academia and the corporates are happening through these career development cells. So in gist, the trend that I'm getting to see is institutions which were profoundly based on academics and curriculum are transitioning to something that I called as talent incubation centers. TICs, talent incubation centers, and they will drift away from this concept of students passing to talent who are employable in the global community. Any questions on the changes and the trends that I am getting to see? Okay, we are coming to an end. I'm just giving you a snapshot of the engagement with the Chandigarh University. The corporate board meets up twice a year. The management and the leadership team of Chandigarh University are accountable to perform against whatever has been agreed upon, and they share with you the scorecards and whatever they have been able to achieve. And in the midst of all that, they also showcase students. Now look, I spent just 10 minutes with this student and I was able to predict that this is the guy that Synopsys should go after. And you see what the guy says. I was able to predict that this is a guy who will do wonders in an environment which Synopsys offers, and it will be mutually beneficial. So he writes a very nice note stating that, well, I have got selected as a summer intern at IIT Powai. He's expressing sincere gratitude for encouraging him during the CAB meeting at Chandigarh University. He says that here I'm currently doing an interesting project in the embedded systems field, which is a great opportunity for me to understand my core electronics and enhancing my skills. I hope you will keep on supporting and guiding me in future also whenever I need your help. He has made me as an informal coach and a mentor. He's signing up with me informally, even before there's a formal engagement that helps him. And he just says that I would want to carry this engagement to the extent that if you can just spare a few minutes for me, I will, you know, be benefiting out of the inspirational words and the sort of engagement that we have. These are some of the recent practices that we are getting to see in the universities which were unheard of in the yesteryears. I'll end my session by the call to action. The mantra is simple. How many of you have read this book called FYI? FYI. For your improvement. Have you even gone through this book? No. If I were to tell you, and if you believe by the end of this session that nurturing competencies are key, then you must buy this book. It's a bit expensive, $85, but it is something that you should use for developing your competencies. Every competency, so let me take a framework. Lominger is known for the competency framework model. They say that they have some 65 key competencies that can make you a CEO. Every competency has been listed out. The career derailers have been listed out. And every competence you have, what is overskilled meaning, what is underskilled meaning, what is optimally skilled meaning. And they are also recommending things that you should do to nurture these competencies. So if you are really serious about having a professional career which is successful, which is tail-raising, do buy this. By the way, I don't get any commission by recommending this book. Huh? So don't, I don't get a penny. But it's something that we have used. I think that people have benefited immensely. The other book that I think is meaningful for all of you before you transition to the corporate is Daniel Goleman's book, Working with Emotional Intelligence. At least I think a couple of you must have gone through that. Daniel Goleman's book? Yes. So few books like these will certainly help you to instill and ingrain. And then it's not just jobs in the corporate. Organizing an event for your institution in terms of maybe this season of seminars or maybe a springtime in IIT Kharagpur, that helps you to manage resources. These are key competencies. Today there were a couple of people from your institute who met me, greeted me, escorted me. So that's all about interpersonal skills. That's all about right communication. So every act of yours offers you a scope to nurture competencies. Dwell on that and you will be at least having an edge which will make you taller than the others who are competing for similar jobs from other institutions. I'll close by offering you Das Ka Dam. Have you heard about the serial called Das Ka Dam? Yes, right? Because Salman Khan was there, right? As an anchor. So the Das Ka Dam from me, in terms of competencies, which is not here, is first, have and nurture global mindset. Boundaries are all breaking. By virtue of my role, wherein I operate out of Bangalore, but I manage all the countries which are beyond US and Canada, I can tell you how important this is. By virtue of the fact that Indian talent are so well prized and they are working as a local hire in Far East, West, in Europe, you must be able to instill this competence called global DNA. That's the first. Second, whatever you do, you cannot dilute your bars around execution. So result orientation is the second competence that you should focus on. Third, communicate, learn how to communicate, master the art of communication, especially when you're handling disagreements, especially when the crucial conversations are required. Fourth, never hesitate to network. Actively network with fellow colleagues, seniors, people who are professionals. Be shameless in terms of exchanging business cards and networking with them and learn from them and become taller. Fifth, people are not robots. Every person requires a different stroke. So there is a saying, different stroke for different folks. So master interpersonal skills. You will have to collaborate, work together, more so in an environment like this in today's era. And interpersonal skills are required. Sixth, agile learning. Fast learning, somebody was talking about GST, somebody's talking about machine learning, artificial, okay, what's this subject all about? Let me at least get a cue. Agile learning. Customer centricity. Anything that you do in any department, in any job, don't focus on the output, focus on the outcome, which is how well is it viewed by your internal or external customers. Eight, you have to embrace change. You have to deal with ambiguity. So the competence that I'm calling out is dealing with ambiguity. Ninth, learn how to persuade. You will all get inducted at not a grassroots level, but you will be inducted at a middle management level being MBA students. And you'll have to know how to take care of the emotions, take care of the egos of seniors, juniors. So just learn how to influence and persuade to achieve the right outcome. And the last of the least is use analysis. Analysis, I think, has come up through big data as a significant skill, but then synthesize. A synthesis skill is connecting the dots. If I am seeing something here, something here, something here, I connect the dots to predict. That is called synthesis skills. With that, I'll close my session. Thank you all for the patient listening. I hope we are doing good with time. If there are any questions, I'll be more than happy to take them at this point in time.
Sir, I read an article saying that by 2020, all the HR entry-level jobs will be outsourced. So, sir, for an HR freshers like us, whether the role of HR will change or will downsize, what's your take on that?
A few minutes back, I was in the boardroom, I was being interviewed, and this is what I had alluded to. The ratio of HR to the overall population is shrinking. Look at my organization. I started with a ratio of 1 HR for every 100. Today we are 1:250. Because there are a lot of jobs that used to be done by HR people, which I think technology has now, you know, brought solutions to. And hence the value-added jobs will continue to be there. And there is nothing wrong. I think, let me go a few years back. And the last time when I was here in this institute delivering a presentation, I think Professor Bala had asked me this question, so what do the guys do at an entry level? It's absolutely okay for you to sign up with companies like MAFO and Team Leases. Remember one thing, any job that you sign up offers you competencies. It will offer you challenges, and the challenges are best overcome by competencies. The moment you start nurturing competencies and then you have a little bit of a functional depth, you will be pulled by companies which require core HR professionals. So I don't think there is a necessity for us to worry about the jobs, but because of the models that various company has, there may be, yes, the entry level jobs are typically being, you know, done by people who are not core to the company, but then it's a job. It's a job and you have to do it well. And all these companies whom I'm talking about, like CareerNet, say TeamLease, say MAFO, we have engaged with them in the past, and there are people whom we have found very worthy, and then we have hired them and pulled them in. So it's a phenomenon that I'm getting to see. That's the first part. The second part is, I have seen innovation in HR. Believe me when I say that this whole project of driving internal mobility in organizations through machine learning is being done by a bunch of freshers. Can you believe it? So we have assessed predictability through, you know, analytics. That's given. That thing is happening. But for a bunch of youngsters to come together, and that's where the model was being talked about, they are now a part of the institute. They are working with the faculty. They are being sponsored by the institute. However, if the solution works out, then we will owe money to the institution. So they will convert institution to profit centers. So there's a lot of innovation also that is being done. And then there are a lot of these depth. Today, the third vertical that I'll talk about is we were at a very superfluous level. There's a high degree of understanding required for business as a business leader in HR today. The other things where we had a very superficial knowledge, those are being eliminated and you have a lot of depth. So there are active people who are engaging from outside with you in terms of how to do a behavioral training and ensure that you do not dilute your behaviors, core behaviors required while you are, you know, interviewing for an organization. So I don't think jobs will get impacted. It is the requirement based on the model of a business and, of course, the sort of richness of the, you know, engagement that we require as a core headcount, because if there are better value propositions that are being delivered by third party to assess and address the situation with juniors, so be it. So be it. Does that answer your question?
Thank you. Sir, you were talking about software security solutions, which will not be provide the hackers any platform to hack the software or any kind of other platform. So my question to you is regarding the, is it that running, like what has happened recently is Game of Thrones has been leaked, and hackers have also threatened HBO that they will leak the another episode of the Game of Thrones as well. So why isn't that, if your software security solutions is so good that it won't allow hackers to go further, so why isn't that HBO is contacting Synopsys?
There's a huge market potential for us, I must tell you. All of a sudden, we have started loving bugs and all these, you know, hackings. I should tell you, in the Gartner report, Gartner is a big organization. I think you have heard about Gartner.
Yes, sir.
They do a lot of... So we have been rated as leaders in the software security segment. And all of a sudden, this whole thing... Forget about that bit. One of the large banks in our country was hacked. You continuously get to hear Aadhaar being compromised, you know? So that's the space that we have gone into. It has just been 3 years. Now, Synopsys has been a company for 30 years. It's an adjacent space that we have gone into, and we are seeing tremendous, tremendous, tremendous amount of potential. So all these people, you're right when you say that they are potential customers to us and they should speak to us.
Same goes with the Aadhaar.
Now, because it's a very sensitive space, you must realize that we also have a large defense requirement for the country. We are engaged with the defense companies also because they fear, and you have heard reports, you know, Pakistan hacking and China hacking our systems. So all these are potential customers to us, and you would see us pretty much there in a period of time. We are already talking about a $500 million business. Okay?
So even Aadhaar card system will also be requiring that software security solutions as well. So
absolutely,
that might also be one very potential customer.
Absolutely. Wherever there is an opportunity for hacking, our tools are geared up to the extent that we do not allow that thing to happen. Because everything is getting digital, right? Everything is getting digital. Today, your and my credentials, if it gets compromised, you know, we are left in a lurch. So it's a great potential for us.
Hello, sir.
Hi.
You talked about scale of integration. Sir, after nanotechnology, as Moore's law said, it would not be every year, the scale of integration doubles. After, I have read it in an article, after 2025, it would not be possible to integrate more circuits in a particular chip. So what is Synopsys doing in this field?
This guy is again taking me back to the year 94, because he has forgotten the time from HR. He's giving me all these questions which are designed for geeky guys, my CEO. But anyway, I'll answer you then. Art DGS, who happens to be the chairman of the board for Synopsys, was in Bangalore to deliver a keynote message for SNUG, which is Synopsys user group. And I had the privilege of having a one-on-one with him. We were driving together from the hotel that he stayed to our campus. I asked him the same question. So Art, we are getting to hear from 64, now it has come down to a 5 nanometer. So are we saying that we will be into a pico mode, because after nano is pico, which is to the power minus 20? And he said, maybe, but then there are other technologies that have come in, which is absolutely getting the Moore's law right, which is FinFET technology, which Intel has brought about, talks about a configuration which is different from the ones that used to be in the past. What it has done is it has increased the surface area to absorb many more times transistors in the same geometry by having the transistors on a vertical mode and not on a horizontal mode. So such technologies keep coming. And I don't know, I can't predict in terms of what will happen, but I have heard geeky guys, people who are into technology and PhD guys saying that, well, Moore's law will continue and continue to stay. Thank you.
I, Kalyani Maitko, student manager, feel honored and privileged to get an opportunity for the Thanksgiving of today's evening. On behalf of Sri Balaji Society, I express my profound gratitude to our guest, Mr. Anshuman Ray, sir, for sparing his valuable time to guide us for a successful career. Sir, we are greatly encouraged by your gracious presence and immensely benefited by your inspiring words.